you guys. I mean, we talk too much about the Academy Awards, because that's not the measure of a movie's greatness always, but I'm going to talk about them now, because in the history of the Academy Awards, two people have been nominated for Best Picture as the producer, Best Director, Best Screenplay, and Best Actor. One of them, of course, Orson Welles for the film Citizen Kane from 1941. The other person has done it twice. For Reds in 1981, a film for which he won the Oscar for Best Director, and the other for the film you just saw, Heaven Can Wait. That other person, as you probably have surmised by now, is Warren Beatty. Ladies and gentlemen, Warren Beatty. I'm guessing that doesn't get old, does it?
No, it never gets old.
Yeah. So, man, that movie, look, I don't think it's fair for television shows and movies to be held to the standard of holding up because you don't make it, right? You're not making it at the time to think, man, I hope people are still watching this in 44 years. Mm-hmm. But, man, that movie holds up.
Really?
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
So that is a remake, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it's a reimagination, but this is great, and I'm not going to go through the whole thing, but
yeah.
It's great because it's a remake of a film from the 1940s, and there was a 1943 film by Ernst Lubitsch called Heaven Can Wait, but that's not the remake.
No, that's not the remake.
That's not the remake.
Here comes Mr. Jordan.
Here comes Mr. Jordan is what you remade. First of all, you'd never directed a film before, so how long had you been thinking, man, I'd like to direct one of these? Because I don't know whether people know this, you were an actor before that, you'd had some success
before.
Yeah, you had.
I was an actor.
Yeah.
I've always thought of making movies as a group of people. You know, and so I had produced movies. The first movie I actually produced was Bonnie and Clyde, thank you. And then I produced Shampoo, so I've always luxuriated in that thing of I don't know why the word fellowship is kind of getting to me, but that. I felt that, it's hard to define what a producer does.
Yes.
And I feel that I've been, a producer longer than a director. But what's your question?
This was the first film you directed.
Yes.
And I'm curious when you thought, all right, so you'd produced Shampoo 3 years earlier, and you produced Bonnie and Clyde a decade before. So, you didn't have to direct. What possessed you to think, okay, now's the time for me to also get behind the camera and take charge of this?
I thought I couldn't avoid it. There were probably other people that I had been thinking about, but then, originally when I was interested in this subject, I've always liked the subject, and I don't know if I ever told you, I wanted to do it with Muhammad Ali.
That's right.
Playing the part.
Because in Here Comes Mr. Jordan, yeah. Robert Montgomery is a boxer.
That's right.
I like that I do this in case you guys don't know what a boxer does.
Boxing, yes.
Yeah.
I was very friendly with Ali. I think he's one of the most entertaining people I've ever known. And
he could have been, hard to believe he wouldn't have been a good actor.
He was a good actor.
Yeah, right.
I mean, he and I loved him, and he he wanted to do it, but he wouldn't stop fighting. And finally, I said, you know, Ali, if you're going to keep fighting, then I gotta. I mean, that's a long story. Me and Ali, and
I'm sure these people don't want to hear about you and Muhammad Ali. That, be honest, I think that sounds pretty dull.
He was funny.
How did you meet Ali?
I don't know.
I'll ask. I'll check with someone else.
But I knew him quite well, and so I said, if you're not going to quit fighting, then because he was a very, very good actor, and a great performer,
right.
and I thought, if you're not going to, then I'm going to change it to a football player, because I had played football, and play it myself, and that's what I did.
But there were also, you also considered, because you were producing the film, so you had a different guy you thought might star in it, and you also you thought somebody else might direct it, too. Like, didn't you, like, you approach some other people to direct it?
I think I was always sort of, I thought I was going to direct it. I wanted to take the full responsibility, you know, and the experiences that I had with Shampoo and Bonnie and Clyde were very positive, with Arthur Penn and Hal Ashby, and I believe a lot in collaboration. I think that's the key, and I think even when you go to the, you know, it's who you are fortunate enough to have work with you, but the great directors that I've known have always had very gifted collaborators, you know.
Robert Altman and McKay.
Bob Altman, yeah. That's something I didn't produce or direct. But I spent a lot of time acting like it. it's an interesting movie because, for several reasons, I really felt with Hal and with Arthur and that once I stepped into producing that I was going to take more responsibility. You know, I didn't do that with McCabe and Mrs. Miller. I tried to do whatever Bob thought, and I could go on and on about Bob Altman, who's really was a very talented person. And I like that movie, you know.
It's special. Mm-hmm. And of course, that both movies we've now mentioned, McCabe and Mrs. Miller and Shampoo, co-starred Julie Christie, who of course we just saw in Heaven Can Wait. Get to her in a minute. So you mentioned that you played football. You played football when?
When?
Yeah, when? I mean, you played in high school or you played in
high school?
High school. You didn't play in college.
No.
But it strikes me that you played.
No, you want to know why I quit football?
I do.
Because I almost went to, you know, I was going to go and play in college. And there was a
you
guy.
You were recruited to go play in college?
Oh, yes. Yeah. I was not bad.
No, I know. Because there's no trickery there. Yeah. That's you throwing
and,
some passes.
In my very last high school game,
yeah,
there was a guy across from me, but I was not a quarterback. I was a middle linebacker and a center. And there was a guy across from me who had a broken arm, and then he had a cast on mm-hmm. his arm. He had broken his arm, and on every play, and those were the days when you didn't wear a face mask.
Sure.
That was a bad sign if you wore a face mask. You were frail or chicken. And on every play, you know, I'd center the ball, and boom, I'd get that cast on the arm, and it kind of knocked
in the face.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Just
and this was a very, I did not like that. and in the middle of it, I thought, you know, I'm not going to take one of these football scholarships. I'm finished with football because I was getting knocked silly. And then a week and a half later, I learned that he had not broken his arm. He was pretending that he had broken his arm and has put his cast on the arm. So I thought, no, I'm not going to do that. So I, What was the question?
Doesn't matter. I don't want to diminish your considerable talent. I mean, four of your, you have 14 Academy Award nominations and four of them for Best Actor, so I don't want to diminish your talent. But you also, you know, I don't know, it's just one man's opinion, but your face was probably worth protecting.
Well,
thank you.
That's very kind of you.
Sure.
I appreciate that, and I do whatever I can do.
Opinion.
And I, you know, I got this. I'm protecting it now. You know,
right. I mean,
but Well. Mm-hmm.
All right. So, because I am struck, there were moments. Speaking of getting hit in the football scene, specifically the practice where Leo Farnsworth wants to play quarterback for the Rams, and you've whipped that body into shape. And the offense is letting the defense right through to give this rich guy who thinks he can show up on a football team and be the quarterback for the Super Bowl, let him have it. Like those, there's no, I don't make movies. Those seems like those guys are Deacon Jones, great all-pro Hall of Famer, Ram lineman, is breaking through and hitting you and knocking you to the ground. There's no stunt quarterback, correct?
Sort of.
But it's you. I mean, the camera pulls back. How was that done? I'm a little dazzled if that's...
Shrewdly.
Okay, all right. Well done.
Well, you know, Deacon was a good guy.
Deacon was there, sure. So why, if you're once you decide to direct, but you bring in Buck Henry, so wonderful is the inept angel, who's been on this stage at the festival twice.
Really?
Once with Diane Cannon for this film.
Oh.
We invited you. You were busy. why bring in a co-director? Was it because it was your first film or because you were...
Well, what had happened is that I'd been working on it with Elaine May, who is wonderful. And
also been here at the festival?
Uh-huh. And then we had some kind of differences of opinion, et cetera. And then I thought, I want to be collaborating. I want to argue. I want to go back and forth and back and forth. And so I thought, I knew Buck very well. I thought he was very reasonable and collaborative, et cetera. And then the Writers Guild would not permit him to be credited as a writer. So I said, well, be a co-director. And so we did that. And
Did it help as a first-time director? And I get it, you've been a producer, but did it help as a first-time director to then to have someone else behind the camera, often in the scenes that you're in, you know, looking at the other actors?
Well, Buck was so incredibly collaborative and so sane, you know. Buck was not just funny.
Yeah.
Buck was hugely talented, and I think he really did enjoy the whole collaborative part of movie making, as he did with Mike, you know, Nichols. And John.
So I'm struck because, you know, I did a conversation a few nights ago, Wednesday night, with John Lithgow here at the festival, and almost many of the same things came out of his mouth, that the thing he likes best about being an actor, by far, is the company of actors, right? That working with other people to create. And that now you've said collaborate, I think, four times. Like, that's the thing you love.
Do you know who I wanted to play John Reed originally in
Reds? Yeah.
John Lithgow.
Is that right?
I thought he looked like him.
Yeah, he does. Well, yeah, that's right.
And then
yeah.
little by little, I came around to saying,
I look enough like him.
We had dinner the other night, and we talked about that.
You and Lithgow had dinner?
Yes.
He is a, that would be a conversation I would enjoy sitting in on. You guys are interesting fellows. James Mason playing Mr. Jordan. Yeah. Who was your first thought for who should play the character of Mr. Jordan? You pursued him. I think you offered him $1 million to play the role.
I did?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. This is what helps when I write. I've probably read this history a little more recently than you have.
For sure. I avoid reading the histories, you know, because it's that's over, you know.
And, yes, that's the thing about history.
I mean, sometimes I don't read. I've never read a book written about me.
Is that right?
Yep.
Because what?
Ten pages I'll read, and I'll say, "Oh, please," and there's I think 15 of them.
You a lot of people? I'm going to get to answer that question for people, but what's the? Did you ever think about? I mean, you've led a really amazing life. Was you, I might add, still living? Important to note. Are you
alive? Yes.
Would you write your own? Have you thought about writing a memoir? I mean, people would.
That's a big subject. A big subject, and I'm not going to go into it. Yes, I think about it, and I almost do it, and then I think maybe I'll do a documentary and kinds of things. It's dealing with that whole area of narcissism that is, I don't know. I've never cooperated with a book. I was hoping to conceal my narcissism.
Right, but you're aware that it was there. So you think what it would be? It would clearly be a challenge to write about it honestly. It would be hard, I think, for anybody.
Well, you'd have to define honest, and and also, if you're going to be very honest, there are a lot of things you would be negative about, people you might be negative about. I don't want to do that.
Yeah. So the answer to the Mr. Jordan question that I was looking for.
I'm not saying I won't do it, though.
I got you. Okay. I know.
Cary
Grant.
What were you going to ask me?
Cary Grant.
I think I did talk to Cary.
Yeah.
And he did not want to do it.
Well, he'd been retired for 12 or 13, 14 years since then. So you're asking him to come out of retirement to play this part. And he, by all accounts, really thought about it. Because this was a kind of a cool.
When you say all accounts, what do you mean?
I mean, I read it on Wikipedia, man. He thought about it, and
he thought it.
He considered it. He didn't just automatically. He didn't hang up the phone. And he would have obviously. Obviously James Mason's great, but it would have been an inspired choice. Cary Grant would have been pretty wonderful, and Diane Cannon, you know, she knew him. and she tried to get him to do it, but he stayed retired, which you have to kind of admire.
Oh,
you don't have to kind of admire. I have to admire. I knew that would happen at least once.
Yes.
So also on the sub, Diane Cannon and Cary Grant weren't together anymore, and she asked him if he'd consider doing the movie. And one of the things I find very interesting about you is that Julie Christie, and you had worked with Julie before, you had been involved with her, but you were no longer involved with her, yet you thought Julie Christie would be great in this, and she's not just great, she shines here in Heaven Can Wait. The world is filled with other actors, yet you were comfortable going to her. I think I think that speaks well of you. I'm desperate for you to say something. anything.
Are you delving into my personal life?
I'm not delving into your personal life. I think everyone would think that it was cool that you would bring aboard someone who you were no longer in a relationship with, and it speaks well of her and of you.
Well, I speak well of her, I can
yes,
tell
I
you
know.
That.
Yeah.
Julie was always an inspiration, really, as an actress and as a person. And she's as wonderful as she looks.
Yeah. I'm a huge sports fan, and I'm amazed at how. Because the Rams played the Steelers in the Super Bowl like a couple of years after the movie came out. So I remember, signs when I see it, I think, oh, they're showing the 1980 season Super Bowl, but which couldn't possibly be because the movie came out in 1978. Uh-huh. So you guys shot that with a fake team. I mean, you were not using real game footage. You created that. Am I wrong?
It was really interesting. We had... the right to put our teams on the field at halftime of an actual Ram game, because we couldn't fill a stadium up.
You know, otherwise, right.
Otherwise. And it was very funny, and I didn't want to goof it up, and so I, as quarterback, and, you know, I had been a linebacker and a center and everything, and I didn't know, as a quarterback, whether I could really fulfill the necessities. And so we got a Canadian football quarterback to come in and do that. I said, I would like you to let me run one play. I just want to see if I can do it. And so he said, fine. And I said, then you'll come in on the second play. And we only had, I think it was something like 17 minutes at halftime that we had to get all this done. And so
That's amazing.
Yeah. And yeah. So I did the one play, and it kind of went kind of well. And so I said, I'm going to do another play. And so I did another play, and that was good. And then I did another play and another play, and I did all 17 plays.
So maybe you didn't get hit in the practices, but that is you in the Super Bowl.
I was willing to be hit.
Well, that's very impressive.
Yes.
Very impressive. The 3 years later, you make here's what surprises me every time I and you and I have become friends, and a friendship that I'm grateful for. You were very close friends with my father, and so it means a lot that I've been able to continue that friendship with you. But in my head, you have directed 17 movies. But that number 17 was clearly in my head. You've directed 19 movies, but you've directed 5.
Is that right?
Just 5, yeah. Well, not just 5. Just let's not qualify it. You've directed 5. What is it about directing that has kept you from doing more? Because you're, you know, Heaven Can Wait, Reds, you're Bullworth. You were quite good at this, and yet you don't do it a lot.
Well, I have made it a point to indulge in this little thing called life.
Sure.
You know?
Yeah.
I have been very fortunate in my superior half, who has, together, we've had what I call 4 small Middle Eastern countries that that sometimes leave the house and they say everything. And now, when I refer to them as small Middle Eastern countries, I mean, I'm not referring to their politics. They're all in their 20s now, and it became much more meaningful to me than making movies all the time, you know. So when I finally made a movie, but I've never made a lot of movies, as you
know. You haven't even acted in as many movies as as, again, people would initially think that you have.
I think
what does your wife do? She yeah.
She does whatever she feels is right, and she's always right, you know. I've been very lucky.
Yeah.
It's been 31 years now.
Very nice. Very nice.
And
so the what was I about to ask? It was good. It was very good. It was really. It was cut. It was going to cut right to the core of
was
who
it,
you are.
Was it racy or
no? It was not. It was. So do you? You have become in this. I know in the pandemic. I hope I'm not revealing too much here. But there's been a wonderful sort of domesticity that has set in, like during the pandemic for you.
I have become, I would say, one of the most skilled, most brilliant washer of dishes.
Very nice, sure.
That you could possibly imagine, and my superior half has become a master chef.
Annette has become a terrific cook.
Yes.
That's nice. That's nice.
And it's been very, very interesting, the changes that this pandemic has wrought. Yes.
So you also, as long as we're talking about family, mm-hmm. and I know it's relevant, particularly tomorrow, you have a sister.
Yeah. I've read that. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
Named?
I believe her name is Shirley McLean.
McLean, yes. Which is,
that her? Yeah.
Which is that, by the way, I know it's her middle name. Is that a family name? Is that your mother's maiden name?
That's my mother's maiden name. Yeah. McLean.
And you will be speaking to her tomorrow because
I will. Well, I'm going to call her. I hope I'll be speaking to
her.
That's
right.
Yes.
But why will you be calling her? It's literally like a hostile witness. Yeah. Your Honor, I'd like to treat the witness as hostile, if I may.
Yeah. Well, you know, Shirley lives on a ranch in New Mexico.
Yep.
And, we talk a lot.
It's her birthday tomorrow. Yeah, that's what I'm getting at. Yeah. I don't think it's a secret. That's also on Wikipedia. Yeah. Uh-huh.
I thought that was just part of, I thought we knew that. You know?
I don't think everybody, no. I just think it's nice. I think people like to hear that. It's nice. You call your big sister on her birthday.
Yeah, well, yeah. But I call her on other days that are not her birthday.
So, do you think, and I'm just, you must think about this.
Yes.
Do you think you will make, whether it's acting or producing or directing, are you interested in making another movie, do you think, if the right thing came along, the right idea sparked you?
Well, I don't think they come along. I think you bring them. And the answer to that question is I don't know.
Yeah.
I find myself more and more interested in what I call this little thing called life.
Yeah.
I'm completely infatuated with fatherhood.
Yeah. Well, yeah. As often as. It sounds like you're pretty good at it, too. You talk about your kids a lot, which is beautiful and lovely and nice. I also want to point out something else just about Warren, because we've had in the last, I don't know, year or so, we've had many meals together. And I would just like to tell one story, if I could. All our meals are, there's a place here in Los Angeles called the Apple Pan. And it is it's got like five things on the menu. It's got basically cheeseburgers and tuna sandwiches and egg salad sandwiches and apple pie. It's largely
Other pies.
There are some other pies. Yes, that's right. Yeah. There are some other pies. Warren, this is how fancy Warren is. All he wants to do is not just eat at the Apple Pan, but talk about eating at the Apple Pan, which is I so identify with.
Yes.
But we went out to a deli once, and I ordered potato skins.
A what?
Potato skins.
A potato what?
Yeah, this is what happened then, too. I get the potato skins, and...
Oh, that's right, I remember that. Potato skins.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah. And you know, I really like them.
You did them, that's right, yeah. It was like, I got to introduce potato skins, and then we get back to your house, and you called Annette, and you were like, listen, Ben Mankiewicz ordered something called what were they called? Potato skins.
Yeah.
Potato skins, yeah. Which was like on the menu of every Applebee's type restaurant from like 1982 to 1997. It was like America's leading appetizer.
Are you sure?
I am totally sure. But I don't think you've been to a Bennigan's. I'm just going to guess that never happened.
You mean you don't think I've done it again?
No, I don't think you've been to an Applebee's. I just don't. I don't see Warren Beatty going to
Applebee's.
Yes.
I didn't even know what you're talking. What is an Applebee's?
Warren, thank you for. Seems like as good a place as any to stop, Warren.
Why do you want to stop?
I don't want to stop.
I don't.
I'm afraid.
you're afraid to keep going?
Yes. You are one of the defining actors, directors, producers of your generation. You've made all of our lives markedly better with your work. You've come here tonight. You honored Leonard Maltin. You've come here to show this film. I can't thank you enough, and I appreciate everything and the friendship you've shown the channel and me. So thank you.
Well, thank you for having me.
Warren Beatty, everybody.
Thank you.